Hey folks, this is Shock. We're going to do another Bible study. You guys love these Bible studies, and I'm really glad because I like doing them. So the feeling, as you know, is mutual. Now, before we begin, I want to give you some good updates on our website. Right here on the top right corner, see where it says shockonnow.net. You want to click below the video in the description after this video is done. And I want to show you a little secret here, how you can go to a lot of different functions on the site. Now you notice when you click more over here, you hold your mouse where it says more, and then what you do is use the mouse wheel and scroll down like this. And a couple of things I want to show you. Get some free audiobooks here, and you scroll up, you can watch the entire movie A Passion of the Christ there, epic movie. You can listen to me on Shock Radio. There's a place here where you can get a free audio Bible. Oh, I know where that's at. You scroll all the way down here, you click free audio Bible, and you definitely want to click free stuff. We got lots of free stuff there for you. Free games, free software, free antivirus programs for your computer and whatnot. So let's begin. Now, this is our continuing series of videos titled Things Jesus Said That Will Shock You. And as you guys know, I used to be an atheist, and I have to admit that I had a preconceived idea of who Jesus Christ was and the nature of Jesus Christ and his beliefs and his I actually just thought he was, in the beginning when I was an atheist, I thought he was just a man, you know, just a prophet or something like that at best. But now I have come to know that he is God. And think about how awesome that is, that God plants himself in the tently flesh of man, in this person, Jesus Christ. So what we're going to go through here with you is some things that shocked me when I read the Bible, and I want you to watch how Jesus is very authoritative. He's unlike any prophets. He's very, very authoritative with his speaking. So we're going to start off at John 3, and what you have here is you have a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. And Nicodemus seems like, from reading this, that he does know there's something different about Jesus Christ. There's something fascinating about Jesus Christ. And a lot of the Pharisees did not like Jesus Christ. And so Nicodemus seems like he's conflicted here. He doesn't want to anger the Pharisees, it seems to me. And notice, he goes to Jesus at nighttime, probably so the Pharisees don't really find out about it. And he says to Jesus, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God." He basically says, look, we know you're sent from God. He says, no one can do the signs that you do unless God is with him. And what a lot of people don't know about Jesus Christ, guys, is that he was exorcising these demons out of people. He'd walk by people, and the people that had demons in them, they'd freak out, and they would say, "What? Why are you here? You know, are you here to torment us before our time? We know who you are, O Son of God." And the demons would actually recognize that he's the Son of God before anyone else did. And they seem very terrified that Jesus is going to torment them. So you have Nicodemus here saying, we know that you are a teacher come from God. Now, I just find this fascinating. Jesus doesn't say, well, thank you, you know, or he doesn't really address what this person's saying. Immediately, Jesus gets to something of the utmost highest importance, I think, of your life personally and my life. If you're skeptical, if you're an atheist, agnostic, or Muslim, whatever, we would all agree, if what Jesus said is true, it is the most important thing in world history. So, knowing that if what he said was true, which I'm about to show you here, it garners our attention. It deserves attention. Look what he says. Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Most assuredly, you guys know what that is. He's saying, look, this is 100% what I'm telling you is truth. If you're not born again, you're not going to see the kingdom of God. You notice there's no wiggle room there. It's cut and dry. So Nicodemus says to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And notice Nicodemus is talking about physical, natural things, and Jesus is talking about spiritual things. Jesus says, most assuredly, again, he says, I say to you, unless one is born of water, and many biblical scholars believe that what he's referring to is what Nicodemus said, you know, natural birth, and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now, this is a very, very narrow statement. This is not a broad statement like, I like Oprah Winfrey, so I don't mean to pick on Oprah and stuff. I really hope she becomes a Christian. But you know how Oprah said, oh, there's all different ways to come to God and everything. Well, that's not really what Jesus is saying. He's specifically saying, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And you know how I said earlier when he said, unless one is born of water, I believe also he's referring to physical birth. And right here, Jesus expounds on that. He elaborates more. He says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. And now notice he's talking about spirit. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel, Jesus says, that I said to you, you must be born again. And then Jesus has this analogy here. He says, look, the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. And you know how sometimes you'll see like these little mini tornado things about the size of a car as they're kind of like starting to blow around, and you actually can see dirt and everything blowing around in there, but you can't really see the wind. What you're actually seeing, what we're seeing when we're seeing the wind blowing, is just the debris, right? Well, let's continue. Nicodemus answered and said to him, how can these things be? And again, Jesus responds differently than, like, let's say you and I would respond as mere human beings. Look what Jesus says. He says, are you the teacher of Israel and you don't know these things? He's basically saying, like, you know, you should know this, is what he's saying. He says, most assuredly I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man, who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not, here's the good news, guys, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Nobody should be offended at Jesus Christ. That is, if truth and goodness and holiness is important to you, you certainly wouldn't be offended at Jesus Christ. And I know you're not. But watch this. Jesus then says something, and if you're a Christian, this is sort of for the Christians out there, I know in our stupid times going on the year 2013, you probably get this phrase a lot. People will say you're narrow-minded. You need to quit being thinking so narrowly, and you need to, you know, have more subjective views. After all, what's wrong for you isn't necessarily wrong for someone else. And you know how stupid our dumb liberal subjective times have gotten, you know. And now we're going on the stupid times of 2013. But Jesus isn't really wishy-washy. He's cut and dry here. He says, look, he who believes in him, remember he was just talking about the Son of Man who comes down from heaven, God's begotten Son. He says, he who believes in him is not condemned. But read this with me, guys. But he who does not believe is condemned already. Now, what do you think the key phrase in here is? Not condemned, okay. What's the key phrase? Already. That struck me as an atheist as I read that. See, what a lot of my atheist friends and I believed is, well, God's not going to judge me, you know, God doesn't exist or whatever, right? And, you know, I'm a pretty good person, and, you know, and you have these standards for yourself that are very, very low. You know, I noticed that our sins always look worse when they're on someone else. But when we sin, oh, it's not that bad, right? So notice, Jesus is saying, he who does not believe is condemned already. That means right now, guys. This is pretty heavy stuff, what Jesus is saying. So there's no need to go ahead and, if you're a Christian and someone says to you that you're narrow-minded, I'm going to show you how you should compliment that person. Because that shows me that you as a Christian, you're on the right track. If you're being called narrow-minded because you believe this right here, what I'm reading in John 3:18, that's good news for you. That shows me you're on the right track. And Jesus continues. Why are they condemned already? He says, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation. Jesus is like, here's the problem. That light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light, and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God. Also notice, Jesus is saying that he's the way. If we don't believe in him, then we're condemned already. This is present tense right now. We're already condemned, right? He goes on to say, and I'll be reading this here, where he says, the wrath of God abides on the sinful man. So, right now, if you're not saved, what Jesus is saying, and I'm reading his exact words here, he's saying we're condemned already. There's no other way around that. It actually says it right there. So, if someone says, well, you're just narrow-minded to think this and believe this, you need to say, you know what, I appreciate you saying that. That shows me that I'm on the right path. The scripture says, you know, wide and broad is the path that leads to destruction, and many are there that take that path, but few enter the narrow path. Now watch this. After these things, Jesus and his disciples came into the land of Judea, and there he remained with them and baptized. Now John was also baptizing in Anah near Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. For John had not yet been thrown into prison. And by the way, I want to hit on something on this baptism. I get so many emails on this, and people always say, well, do you have to be baptized to be saved? And there's really no debate on this. Just go get baptized. The thief on the cross, there's no evidence that he was baptized. You know, Jesus didn't say, if you want to be saved, you know, well, did you get baptized? You know, so, but rather than arguing about it and debating amongst brothers and sisters, just go get baptized. I think it's a wonderful thing for all of us to do it. Even Jesus himself was baptized, and John said, well, you know, you want me to baptize you? Basically, you know, Jesus is an authority, and Jesus said, permit it to be so we can fulfill all righteousness. So this dispute comes about here. Check this out. There arose a dispute between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purification. You know, like you clean your hands and you purify yourself and you do these little different rituals before meals. John answered and said, oh, by the way, I jumped ahead here. They approached John and they tell John, look, he's baptizing, you know, Jesus' disciples and are baptizing, and they're saying, and now people are coming to Jesus. And John answered and said, this is John the Baptist, look, a man can receive nothing unless it has been given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. So John's basically confirming that Jesus is the Messiah. And he says, therefore this joy of mine is fulfilled. He must increase. Look at the humbleness of John. He must increase, but I must decrease. He who comes from above is above all. And notice John speaking of Jesus' divinity, that Jesus did come down from heaven. He who is of the earth is earthly and speaks of the earth. He who comes from heaven is above all. And what he has seen and heard, that he testifies, and no one receives his testimony. He who has received his testimony has certified that God is true. For he whom God has sent speaks the words of God. So notice Jesus is taking the place of God, speaking the words of God. For God does not give the Spirit by measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life, John says here. And he who does not believe, look guys, he who does not believe the Son, I'm reading from, let me give you the actual passage because everyone always asks me this. John 3:36. Look what John the Baptist is saying. He says, he who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he's backing up what Jesus said earlier here. And he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but here it is, but the wrath of God abides on him. Let's mosey on to the next page. Why would the wrath of God abide on you and I? Well, if we've ever lied, if we've ever stolen anything, you know how it goes, irrespective of its value. If we've ever hated someone, these are all sins. We're all sinners, guys. I don't mean to beat you over the head with it, like with a hammer. You know, we're all sinners, me included. I think it's time that a lot of us, people need to grow up and realize that the wrath of God abides on them. We're all sinners. Everyone knows it. I think there comes a time in our lives where we say, you know what, let's be adults about this. Let's take this seriously. Every single person's going to die. And even Jesus said, you know, what does it profit you to gain the whole world but lose your soul? And what can you give in place of your soul? So, you know, I do believe what Scripture says, where it says, you know, how can we forsake so great a salvation? So watch this. When the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, Jesus finds out about it, he leaves Judea and departs again to Galilee. But on his way there, he has to go through Samaria. So he comes to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. So there is a well there where people would go there and draw water, right? And it's called Jacob's Well. And Jesus was there being wearied. Now notice, he's wearied. He has the physical body of man. So he could actually get tired and hungry and experience things that you and I experience. being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, and this might take some explaining, but let me go through it. She asked Jesus, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman?" Notice it says, "For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,'" and this is this real beautiful conversation that they have together. Watch this. It's almost poetic. Jesus says, "You would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with." There's no, he doesn't have like a bucket or anything like that, right? "And the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Look, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But that water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." Now, let's get very, very personal right now. If you're watching this video, going through this, do you feel fulfilled in your life? Do you feel like something is missing? Do you feel like there's got to be something more to life than just making as bunch of money as we can, and eating a lot of great food? And certainly nothing wrong with doing these things. There's money is not the root of all evil. It's the love of money, Scripture says, that the root of all evil. But if that's all there is, you see a lot of these people, these entertainers and these people make these sports athletes, and their lives are so messed up with drugs and just all types of stuff, you know. Not all of them, but they'll talk about how, you know, it just doesn't satisfy them. And I have to tell you, in my personal life, I've always felt like there had been something missing when I was an atheist, and I'm like, you know, is this all there is, you know? And it's been said that we all have a hole in our heart, and it's in the shape of God, and it needs to be filled, and Jesus Christ fills that hole in our heart. I really believe that. And this world is so challenging, and it has its trials and setbacks, and you just see people literally going insane as the world makes them go crazy. I mean, I can't believe, I open up the newspapers and I'm like, man, this world really needs Jesus Christ. And if you are feeling that way, that, you know, come on, there's got to be something more to this. Hey, look what Jesus says, my friend. He says, "Whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst." And I want to tell you guys, I am completely satisfied. I am so fulfilled. It's great to have an objective purpose in life. And as a Christian, you have an objective purpose in life. You know, when I was an atheist, and even my atheist friends now will tell you that an atheist life really just ends in death. There is no objective purpose that someone could have as an atheist. And this is why atheism has some of the highest suicide rates out there. You know, you don't hear people saying, "Oh, when I became an atheist, I got off drugs and I quit drinking and I quit." You don't hear that. But I hear this all the time in the Christian community. You see people leaving their homosexual lifestyle. There's a a great YouTube channel, P.P. Simmons, and they also have a radio show, and they were talking to someone that was in the homosexual lifestyle, and they left it, and they became a Christian. So you see people like that. I know people that were alcoholics, and they became Christians, and they left their alcohol problem, their drug problem. You see these radical changes. I don't hear people saying, oh, since I've become atheist, I'm so fulfilled. What I see is the complete opposite. I see this extremely high suicide rate in atheism. But hey, fill up on what Jesus said here. He says, the water I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. And guys, I'm telling you, you ain't ever going to thirst again. So the woman says to him, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst. See, she's thinking of a natural solution. Nor do I need to come here anymore to draw. Jesus said to her, and this is odd right here. He says, go call your husband and come here. Why would he say that? The woman answered and said, I have no husband. And this is almost like comedy here, this conversation. Excuse me, look at this. Jesus said to her, you have well said, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands. Oh, burn. Look, and she says, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. And then he's not putting her down or anything. He's just saying, look, I know your life. He says, and in that you spoke truly. So the woman, notice how she sounds now. Something changes in her now. And she says, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. And now she's starting to talk about spiritual things. Interesting. Maybe she's trying to change the subject over here, right? She says, our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. Jesus said to her, look, woman, believe me. The hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. He tells her, you worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. And it's, look what Jesus says here. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Let me get a little bit scientific on you here. Do you know there's an argument that Christians will bring up called the cosmological argument? And it goes like this. Whatever begins to exist, and it talks about the universe being a good evidence of God's existence. It goes like this. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist. Therefore, the universe has a cause. Notice what it says here. God is spirit. It's interesting that, for example, Anthony Kinney of Oxford University says if someone's an atheist, they must believe that the universe came from nothing and by nothing. But we know that's impossible because nothing is the absence of anything. There was no pre-existing matter, energy, even time itself had to come into existence. Even the singularity had to come into existence. There was no natural materials. And isn't it interesting that God is not natural materials? God is spirit. Well, there are only really two things that exist necessarily. Some people believe, I should say, that numbers, for example, exist necessarily. A lot of people believe these type of things exist necessarily. God exists necessarily. They're timeless. That is, they've always existed. They always will. And since the universe has a beginning, science has already proven that all evidence shows that the universe had a beginning. The Bohr-Gutzel-Lincoln theorem shows that all evidence shows the universe had a beginning. Well, we got a couple of choices. Nothing did it. That doesn't make any sense. Or God did it, or numbers did it. Well, numbers can't create anything. The number 7 can't create anything. So it follows rationally that a powerful God created the universe. And notice, God is not a material object. He is spirit. And Jesus says, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ, and when he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Now about that time, at this point, his disciples come and they marvel that he's talking with a woman, and a Samaritan at that, by the way. Yet no one questioned him and said, well, what are you seeking, or why are you talking with her, right? The woman then left her water pot, went her way into the city. And notice, she leaves her water pot. What is that, an act of kindness? She's allowing them to have it to draw the water. You see that? Interesting. She went her way into the city and she tells all the men there, come see a man who told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came to him. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. Because remember earlier up there, I won't scroll up again, but remember, let's scroll up. I want to give you the, I want to make sure. Okay, notice it says, Jesus therefore being wearied from his journey. And excuse me, notice the disciples, they recognize this and they're urging him, Rabbi, you know, come on, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. Therefore the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him anything to eat? Notice they're concerned about him. They want to make sure that, you know, he's taken, got food and he's being taken care of and stuff. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest. And he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this the saying is true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you have not labored. Others have labored and you have entered into their labors. What is he talking about? He's talking about them preaching the gospel, and he's talking about how other prophets before them laid the foundation for Jesus Christ. John the Baptist, for example, laid the foundation for his coming onto the scene here. And notice Jesus is saying, one sows and another reaps. Sometimes I'll be talking to someone and they'll actually accept Christ and become a Christian. I'm like, gosh, that was like so easy. I mean, this person gets it, you know. Well, probably what's happening is I'm reaping, right? And someone else has sowed the seed and talked to them about the gospel and has showed them how it makes rational sense. And then I'll come along and I'll say something and it's just like they get it, right? And then sometimes I'll be talking to someone and maybe I don't see any change. I don't see them become a Christian, and I'm sowing that seed, and another Christian will come along and bring them into the kingdom, and they will become a Christian. So some of us guys, when you're preaching the word, will be sowing and others will be reaping. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified. Remember the woman at the well? He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans had come to him, they urged him to stay with them. Notice that they love Jesus. They want him to stay with him. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his own word. There's something about Jesus Christ where people would question him, they would talk to him, and they would believe him. Then they said to the woman, notice what they're saying to the woman now, now we believe, not because of what you said, for we ourselves have heard him, and we know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. I don't know what I could have done, guys, if I could have walked with Jesus Christ when he walked in the tently flesh of man. I mean, that just would have been epic. And there's something about him, the way he spoke, the words he spoke, you can tell when I'm going through this, that's totally different than what a man would speak. And even now, in the, going on the year 2013, no one has changed the world than Jesus Christ. No one has changed the world more than Jesus Christ. Just phenomenal. The ripples are still going through time. Now, after the 2 days, he departed from there and went to Galilee, for Jesus himself testified. Notice, this is another interesting, shocking thing that Jesus says. He said, a prophet has no honor in his own country. Interesting. So when he came to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things he did in Jerusalem at the feast, for they also had gone to the feast. So notice, everywhere he's going, the people, just like you and I, you know, the normal, average, everyday Joes, they're accepting him. It's really interesting, and this is another thing that shocked me when I started reading scripture. It was the ultra-religious people that make void the word of God by their meaningless traditions that were the enemies of Jesus Christ. It wasn't people like you or I. It was the ultra-religious people that make void the word of God by their meaningless traditions that Jesus was having issues with. They're always criticizing him. So Jesus came again to Cana of Galilee, where he made the water wine, and there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus had come out of Judea into Galilee, he went to him and implored him to come down and heal his son. He's basically begging Jesus, right? The son's about to die. He was at the point of death. Then Jesus said to him, and this is another shocking thing that he says. He says, look, unless you people see signs and wonders, you will by no means believe. The nobleman said to him, sir, come down before my child dies. Jesus said to him, go your way, your son lives. So the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, your son lives. Then he inquired of them the hour when he got better, and they said to him, yesterday at the seventh hour the fever left him. So the father knew, interesting, look, that it was the same hour in which Jesus said to him, your son lives. And he himself believed, and his whole household. And his whole household, I should say. This again is the second sign Jesus did when he had came out of Judea into Galilee. There was this pool of Bethesda, and a rumor had it that an angel would come and stir up the waters, and then everyone would get into the waters, people that had ailments, and they'd be healed of their sickness, right? Now, I want to read this to you here. I don't know if that's true or not, if that really happened, if the angel was doing it. But if I had to bet one way or the other, I would say yes, because look at this. It says, after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. Notice what it says. Interesting. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. That's just kind of unusual. And watch this. I want to read something to you. It says, now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, do you want to be made well? Jesus doesn't make any reference to the angels or the water or anything like that, right? But the man does. The man says, sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me. Jesus said to him, rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed, and walked. And now look what the ultra-religious people do. And that day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said to him who was cured, "It is the Sabbath. It is not lawful for you to carry your bed." But notice Jesus just told him to do it. He answered them, "He who made me well said to me, 'Take up your bed and walk.'" Then they asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk'?" Notice they're going to bust Jesus here, like, "Oh, let's go talk to Jesus. Why did he tell you to do that?" But the one who was healed did not know who it was. The guy had never met Jesus before, for Jesus had withdrawn, a multitude being in that place. So it's just a big crowd, and he can't figure out where Jesus is at. Now here's what's really interesting. Jesus returns to this guy that he healed, and he finds him in the temple, and Jesus says to him, "See, you have been made well." Now look at this, guys. This is shocking. What was this guy doing that Jesus would say this? Jesus says, "Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." Interesting. Now, the Bible is silent on what was this guy was doing, but interesting, notice, Jesus tells him basically, "Hey, sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." The man departed and told the Jews, now he knows, oh, okay, I know who it is now, that it was Jesus who had made him well. For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him. Why? Look, because he had done these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, notice he's referring to God as his Father. He says, "My Father has been working until now, and I have been working." Therefore the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father. Look, guys, making himself equal with God. It can never be argued that Jesus never made himself equal with God. He does it throughout all of Scripture. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do." Jesus is now, not only is he saying that he's making himself equal with God, he's saying that he's seen God. He says, "For whatever the Father does, the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself does. And he will show him greater works than these, that you may marvel." He's like, Jesus is like in your face with it, right? "For as the Father raises the dead and gives life to them, even so the Son gives life to whom he will. For the Father judges no one," and here's another interesting passage, very important, "but has committed all judgment to the Son." Do you see that? "That all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him." He's basically saying, look, if you don't honor me, you don't honor Jesus Christ, you're not honoring God. "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Most assuredly," again he says, "I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself," here it is again, notice the Father's granting the Son all these things, "so he has granted the Son to have life in himself." And again, "has given him," he's given Jesus, "authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this," Jesus says, "for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth." Now, this is another very shocking thing that Jesus Christ says. Look what sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus says. We believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. We love him. Well, then let's listen what he says. Look, guys. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. It's interesting that Jesus doesn't believe in subjective morality. Notice he's talking about good and he's talking about evil. I bring this up because when I debate atheists, they want to blur the lines. They don't want to say there's any such thing as good and evil. It's the complete opposite of what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying good and evil. Notice that. And then he even says, those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. So they basically are resurrected and then judged and condemned. The ones that have done good, they're resurrected, notice, to life, to the resurrection of life. And Jesus says, I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. If I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. There is another who bears witness of me, and I know that the witness which he witnesses of me is true. You have sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth, and that's true. Remember, John the Baptist did that. Yet I do not receive testimony from man, but I say these things that you may be saved. John, he says, was the burning and shining lamp, and you were willing for a time to rejoice in his light. But I have a greater witness than John's, for the works which the Father has given me to finish, the very works that I do bear witness of me, that the Father has sent me. And the Father himself who sent me has testified of me. Now, another shocking thing. You have neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his form. But you do not have his word abiding in you, because whom he sent, him you do not believe. You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And these are they which testify of me. He's saying the scriptures are all about me, Jesus Christ. He says, but you are not willing to come to me that you may have life. Listen to that. Talk about a spiritually packed sentence. That says it all. He says, but you are not willing to come to me that you may have life. I do not receive honor from men, but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in you. I have come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, him you will receive. He's showing them, look, it doesn't make sense the way you guys are thinking. He says, how can you believe who receive honor from one another and do not seek the honor that comes from the only God? Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. For if you believe Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. Now, notice he's talking about Moses writing about Jesus Christ. And he says, but if you do not believe Moses' writings, how will you believe my words? So Jesus is trying to get them to listen to reason. We're almost done, guys. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Then a great multitude followed him because they saw his signs, which he performed on those who were diseased. And Jesus went up on the mountain and he sat with his disciples. Now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near. Then Jesus lifted up his eyes, and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? But this he said to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have even a little. He's like, there's no way we can feed all these people. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there's a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish, but what are they among so many? Then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, so that nothing is lost. Therefore they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men, when they had seen the signs that Jesus did, said, this is truly the prophet who has come into the world. Now, the next passage, a lot of pastors will do a little Bible study on this here. It says, therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, they're so enamored by Jesus, they want to just usher in the kingdom. They're going to actually get Jesus by force, lift him up on their shoulders, and force him to become a king, right? He's realizing, you know, they're starting to get really excited about making him the Messiah here, right? He departed again to the mountain by himself alone. Now when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into the boat, and went over the sea toward Capernaum. And it was already dark. So imagine this. You're on the sea and it's dark. Okay? And Jesus had not come to them yet. So the sea... notice it says, then the sea arose because a great wind was blowing. So now the waves are getting pretty scary. So when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, imagine you're 3 or 4 miles out there on the sea, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and drawing near the boat, and they were afraid. But he said to them, it is I, do not be afraid. Then they willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. So it's interesting, he gets into the boat, and all of a sudden they're, you know, it's like Jesus just speeds it up, you know, and they're already at the other side. So check this out. So, because look, that's what it says. It says, then they were willingly received him in the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. So, evidently they felt that was important to write that immediately the boat was at the land where they were going, right? On the following day, when the people who were standing on the other side of the sea saw that there was no boat there, except that which one his disciples had entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but his disciples had gone away. See, they're trying to figure it out, and you see what Jesus did here. My suspicion is, look what was happening here. Jesus is smart, I'm telling you. Look what was happening. They're going to take Jesus by force. Remember that? They're going to take him by force. Jesus is sensing it. Right here. Therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him by force, not to harm him, but they were going to make him a king, right? He departed again to the mountain by himself alone. So you know the crowd's looking for Jesus. I mean, we would all agree with that. They're looking for him, right? And they know he's hanging out with the disciples. So notice, Jesus, he's so smart. Look, he lets the disciples go. And so probably when the disciples go and everyone's seeing that Jesus isn't with them, the crowd probably is like, oh, all right, well, let's all go home then, you know. So the next day, notice the crowd's still looking for him. It says, when the people were standing on the other side of the sea, saw that there was no other boat there except the one which his disciples had entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but his disciples had gone away alone, However, other boats came from Tiberias near the place where they ate bread after the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they can't figure out how he did it, right? You saw that he walked on the water. They also got in the boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him, they're like, how did he get here? They said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? And look at Jesus here. He knows their hearts, right? He says, most assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. And he goes, look, don't labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. And I think we're going to end it here, guys, because this is good. This is beautiful. Then they said to him, because look what Jesus just said. And they're listening to him. They're not being jerks about it. They're really sincerely listening and open. And I hope you guys, if you're not a Christian yet, I hope you're really sincerely listening to this and opening to the message of Jesus Christ. Look, he tells them, look, don't labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life. You know, the good stuff. This is of more value. He's not saying choose the junk. He's saying choose the valuable stuff. You know, the food which endures to everlasting life. And he says, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. And this is where it gets really beautiful. This really makes me happy reading this. I love when I'm talking to someone and they're humble and they've got an open heart for Jesus Christ and they really listen to it. It's just so pure and it's so good when that happens. I love that. And it's rare sometimes in these stupid times that of ours going on the year 2013. But when you get someone like that and they're open to it like these people, I mean, watch how beautiful this is, guys. Watch. Then they said to him, remember, because he just said, you know, don't labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life. They say to Jesus, look at, they got a good heart here. They say, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? They're asking the good questions. And Jesus, you could tell he's pleased with that. They're on the right track. Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. Guys, it's pretty easy. And you notice how God gets all the glory when we do that. Therefore they said to him, what sign will you perform then that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do? Our fathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. And here it gets really good. Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And this is epic. They said to him, Lord, give us this bread always. Isn't that awesome? These people, they got it. They understood it. They got it. They're on the right track. And it's my prayer that if you guys are listening to this, that you would say that, Lord, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. Remember when he was talking to the woman at the well? And he said, look, you know, this water, you're going to get thirsty again. He goes, but I'm going to give you something. You're not going to thirst. It will satisfy you. And he says, he who comes to me shall never hunger. And he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me." Look what he's just said there. For I have come down from heaven. Guys, you want to learn about God? You want to know the nature of God? Look at Jesus Christ. That is the true nature of God. And look at how much he loves you. And Jesus says, "This is the will of the Father who sent me." What is the will of the Father? Look, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me. Here it is. This is God's will, guys. This is God's will for you. That everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. God bless you guys, and thanks for watching. You have a great week.